The Earth, as seen from Neptune, looks no more than a fraction of a dot. Zoom out from this vantage point to outside of the Milky Way, and the Sun gets lost in the immensity of the stars in our galaxy. Zoom further out to distant galaxies, and the Milky Way appears no more than a mote of dust. It is this extraordinary immensity of space that gives us the feeling that the Earth is an insignificant place in the grand scheme of the universe. And significant too, precisely because for now, as much as we know, it is the only planet that harbors life. But if the universe is so staggeringly big, where are the other planets that are Earth-like, and what would make them a hospitable place for life? Or, in more scientific terms, what makes a planet an Earth analog? First, let's do some crude maths. Our Sun, which is one of the 100 billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy, harbors in round figures 10 planets. The Milky Way has 100 billion stars. Assuming all the stars to be like the Sun, we'd expect a trillion planets in the Milky Way galaxy itself. And since there are 100 billion such galaxies in the universe, the total number of possible planets is about a billion trillion. But despite such simple calculations that give us a sense of the huge number of potential planets, the fact that other stars harbor planets was not observationally confirmed until 1992. It was the data of light source from the star PSR B1257+12 which gave us the first evidence of exoplanets. Unlike our Sun, which emits light in the visible domain, this star emitted rays in the form of radio waves. This is due to the fact that it was a pulsar, in other words, a star which constantly emits light wave only in one direction as it rotates. So, if you looked at a pulsar through a telescope, you'd see hundreds of blinks of radio waves emitted every second. As these waves were periodic in nature, that is, had bright regions as well as dark ones, you'd expect a sinusoidal graph like this one, with this region representing the presence of light and the absence of light at this point. But in reality, we saw a deviation from a sine wave like this, and inferred such a blip was down to an exoplanet. Using similar mathematical technique in 1995, they came about a discovery of planets around a sun-like star. Then started the development of better techniques and precise measurements to hunt such planets down. One of the methods was determining the presence of exoplanets using transit, whereby a planet, as it comes close to a star, dips its brightness in some amount. The other way to infer the presence of exoplanets is by the method of gravitational lensing, whereby the star's gravity acts as a lens. Think about a normal lens which converges rays of light from its various parts at a particular point, like a magnifying glass that you might have used to burn a paper. In the same way, when a planet is behind a star, the star, instead of blocking the light, bends it due to its gravitational force. This means that you get higher intensity of light in the telescope. This is because now the intensity is equal to the intensity of the light of the star, as well as the intensity of the light of the planet. In all of these three methods, we infer the presence of exoplanets, not see them directly. But modern telescopes have become so powerful that we're able to see them and not simply infer their presence. But discovering an exoplanet is not the same as that of finding an Earth-like planet. There are a few other crucial steps to get there. First, we have to know the size of these planets. In any solar system, there's a boundary, a cutoff, beyond which the planets become a gas giant. In our solar system, this cutoff is the asteroid belt. Beyond the asteroid belt, the planets get bigger and bigger. On the opposite end of the spectrum, there are also planets that are equally big and so close to their stars that they orbit their stars in a matter of a couple of days. These are dubbed as hot Jupiters and have a rich preponderance of hydrogen and helium, which is why they're also referred to as failed stars. So, an Earth-like star could be in what is termed as a habitable zone, a zone that is neither too far nor too distant from its star. The presence of an exoplanet in a habitable zone might allow the presence of life as seen on the Earth. This is because water is a necessary component for the presence of Earth-like life. And an exoplanet within the habitable zone means that the probability of finding liquid water is also higher. Deviate from the habitable zone and get too close to the star, water vaporizes. The temperatures go on soaring from a few hundred to thousands of degrees. Get too far from the star, the water gets frozen at unbelievably low temperatures. The other property that makes a planet Earth-like is whether it is terrestrial. That is, whether it has a surface that is solid, made from silicate, rocks, and metals. With such geographical features, any terrestrial planet has the capability to be terraformed. That is, we could, through sophisticated technique, modify the atmosphere and surface ecology in such a way that its environment mimics that of the Earth and supports Earth-like life. An example of that was shown in the 2016 blockbuster Martian. In order to look for Earth-like planets, scientists tend to look around stars that are comparable to the size of the Sun or smaller. This is because the stars that are greater than 8 times that of the Sun die within 8 to 10 million years. Compare that to the evolution of life on Earth, which has taken a few billion years. Besides, these massive stars, when they die, go out in spectacular fashion in a burst known as supernova explosion. This scatters the mass of a few suns in various directions. Such a burst would kill potential life in its vicinity. If we were simply looking for astronomical bodies where humans could possibly settle, it is not necessary that we look only for a planet. We could also look at the habitability of natural satellites. Even within our own solar system, Jupiter's moons like Europa, Callisto, Io, as well as Saturn's satellites such as Titan and Enceladus are conjectured to have subsurfaces of liquid water and other molecules like oxygen, hydrogen, and even complex organic molecules, which, as we know, are building blocks of life. There have been various planets that are similar to the Earth that have been discovered. One such planet is Kepler-442b, that is twice as heavy and twice as massive as that of the Earth. It is also thought that the planet is rocky and solid, like our own planet. There's one little problem though that always seems to plague us when we hear an exciting news that we've finally come across an Earth-like planet. And that is the problem of distance. Kepler-442b is 1200 light years away. Even if you could travel at a speed where you would reach the United States of America from Nepal, say within the snap of your fingers, it will still take you 30,000 years before you reach Kepler-442b. To give you a better perspective, if that flight from Nepal to the United States of America cost you 1 cent only, the cost of getting to Kepler-442b on that flight would be close to $100,000 billion. Getting to an exoplanet in the closest star other than the Sun would cost you $100 billion. Our current travel technologies will not deliver us to any of these exoplanets, in the foreseeable future at least. These are interesting times though in astronomy, with so many exoplanets and other Earth-like objects being discovered. The discoveries of such bodies might push technologies to get better and may even make short-term interstellar travel to, say, the Moon or Mars quite cheap and regular in the coming decades. But not now, not anytime soon. For now, the preservation of our only home and the only place that can harbor life as we know it, the Earth, should be our greatest priority.